Okay, so I'm going to introduce our speaker. Our speaker is David Newell from Boulder Aerospace, and he has been working on the passive microwave sensing of moisture or precipitation in the atmosphere. This is a model of their instrument.
Thank you. So as Bill said, my name is David Newell. I work at Ball Aerospace. I've been at Ball Aerospace for about 20 years. Before that, I was at JPL for 5 years. And before that, I was at the University of Colorado getting my master's degree. Took this course with Bill when I was here, and was a good kind of launching pad into the work that I've done. So with the remote sensing class and some other classes that I took here at Ball, I got involved with the science end of things, looking at the products from different instruments and sensors, how to look at the science end of it. And then my primary degree was an aerospace engineering degree with the standard structural, mechanical, electrical design activity. So I started my career in instrument design, and as I've kind of grown in my career, I've branched out into more mission development and working with NASA and other customers that come and say, we want to do this, how can you design an instrument or a system that will do this for us? So the latest one that I've been working on has been the GMI instrument for the GPM program. GPM program is the Global Precipitation Mission, and it's looking to measure rainfall over the entire surface of the Earth. So, and the instrument, the particular instrument, is the GMI instrument, and it's a microwave radiometer. So I'll go into more details on the radiometer and the design and some of the science that it's doing. But I first wanted to try to look again kind of on the science side, on the product side, on, you know, why are we doing this? Why are we interested in doing this? So this is an image of the first year of data from the microwave instrument, actually the entire system that was put together, but that's primarily driven by the GPM instruments. So this is a look at the globe with the rainfall, snowfall, the precipitation that's occurring over the entire globe. So we launched in February, so now this is getting out to July, and so this is combining the GMI instrument with a number of other instruments that are sensing the globe and putting together a total image. So you can see here, you can see the normal flows that you would expect with the equator, the heating that's going on at the equator, the typical drive, and then the higher latitudes on both sides. There's a lot of interesting things you can see here. But kind of focusing on the U.S., if you're interested in what's going on in the U.S., of course, you're interested in what's going on out here in the Pacific Ocean. There aren't a lot of things that are measuring what's going on out over the Pacific Ocean. If you get to the coast of California, they've got big radars. You can sense the rain rate. You see that on the news every night. So you know what happens when you get close to the coast. But what's really going to affect the weather is what's going on out here in the Pacific Ocean. So is this storm that's coming across right now, is it raining a lot? So is it giving up all of its energy out over the ocean? Or is it holding all that energy so when it makes it to the coast, it's still got all that moisture, it's still got all that energy, and it's going to turn into one of those powerhouse storms that really drive in? In order to be able to measure and predict that, you have to measure and see what's going on out over the ocean. With the optical sensors, they look at the top of the clouds, and you can infer what's going on inside those clouds. But the goal of the GPM mission is to look inside and look inside here and see what's going on inside, actually measure the precipitation that's going on that's driving all these functions. And then do that not only for the Pacific, the Northern Pacific, which we're really interested in for the weather forecasting for the United States, but do this over the entire globe where you can start to do analyses and look at the effects of global warming and how things are changing over long term. But once you have these global pictures, you can start doing longer term analyses and trends and studies to look at these types of things. So, like I said, this is the first year of the GPM data. Before GPM was launched, you couldn't generate this image. What you'd get is some swaths of data from some separate instruments that were fairly unconnected. Most of the instruments are polar orbiting, and so you get like one swath of data over each part of the Earth every day, essentially, is what you're going to get. And so you'd get these kind of disconnected swaths of really high resolution data without a good way of tying them together. So the goal of the GPM program, the GMI instrument that we built, was to put together a system that could produce the images that you're seeing here, total global precipitation on a very short time frame. These are I think 15 minute time slices. So on a very short time scale, 15 to 30 minutes, come up with these types of measurements on the entire global surface. So that was a very challenging goal. Here, so let's go to the all right. So as I said, this just says in words what I just said with the images. The objective was to take all of these instruments that were currently out there and tie together into an integrated system that allowed these global perspectives, global measurements of precipitation, both rain and snow, over the entire globe on a very short time scale. As you guys know, living in Colorado, what was happening half an hour ago has very little relevance to what's going on now, especially in the summertime. Half an hour ago, it could be completely clear, beautiful, sunny sky. 30 minutes later, you're in a torrential downpour, hail's coming down on top of you. 30 minutes later, the sun's coming out. So if you send an instrument over and it measures and you get something, and then 2 hours later you get another measurement, it's very hard to tie those together. So it has to be measurements on the time scale of the science that you're trying to do. For rainfall, most of the tropical rainstorms are very short-lived, they're fast-moving, and so you have to do measurements on that type of a scale. So the concept that they came up with for meeting those science requirements was called the GPM mission, Global Precipitation Mission. And what it did was it said, okay, there's no one instrument that we can do that can measure every place on the Earth with these kind of 30-minute time scales. There's no instrument that will do it. And if we go try to build our own constellation of instruments, we're going to have to put up 10 instruments at $500 million an instrument. We don't happen to have $5 billion to get this rain product. And so what they did is they went and looked at the existing instruments that are already up there that may not have been focused on precipitation, but that were measuring microwave signals that could be used to get precipitation. And then there was the question about how to tie all those together. The problem is you got this instrument and it measures things and it says, well, it's raining here. And another instrument looks at it and says, no, it's not raining there. Because of differences in the instrument, different frequency content, different things that they're doing. And somehow you have to tie all those things together. So the way that they did that was that they planned on flying the GMI instrument in a low inclination orbit. So most of the satellites are polar orbiting. They go up over the poles. This is a low inclination orbit here that would then cross all of the orbits of all of these other instruments. And so you'd get these co-located measurements of both the GPM and all of these other instruments. And that would allow the cross-calibration of all these different instruments. So you'd look at it, there'd be a difference between the two. And so then you'd say, okay, well, we're going to take GPM as the reference, and we'll make this other instrument look like GPM. So we'll adjust it until it looks like GPM. You do that for all of those instruments on orbit. Now everything starts looking with like the same measurements that GPM is measuring, and now you can start to put together those, that kind of consistent view that I showed there. Before GPM was in orbit, what you would have seen is these kind of storms would have come and disappeared, and they would have showed up, and then they get really intense when the next storm came over, and then they get like really mild, as all of these different instruments made their own independent measurements by having the GMI, the GPM spacecraft underfly all of these polar orbiting systems. It's able to bring those together into an integrated operational system and then meet these requirements they have by using the existing assets and this one additional asset to tie everything together. So as I said, GPM, it has an active radar, and then it has the GMI instrument. So GMI is a passive instrument. It's looking at the natural microwave emissions that are coming off of the Earth to infer, to measure the rainfall. So it's mainly interested in looking out over the oceans. That's because we don't have radar systems out over the oceans. Most of the areas on land are fairly well covered with radars. You get out over the oceans, you don't have those radars, and that's really where weather is driven. It's where it starts, it's where it's most interactive, it's where it gets all of its energy. So knowing what happens out over the ocean is really important. Ultimately, the products, as you saw, those look like just like the maps that we see on the nightly news, on the weather station on the nightly news. That's the type of things that we're going to look for. So here's the instrument. You have the land, you have the ocean down here. It has microwave emissions. It's emitting microwaves. As the rain comes out of the clouds, it actually interferes with that signal that you're seeing coming up from the ground. And it's by looking for that interference pattern that you know is different at different frequencies that you can determine where it's raining, how hard it's raining, what type of precipitation is occurring as it comes up. Now, there's a lot of things that interfere with that signal. You can change the surface of the water. You can get wind over the water, which changes the emissions. You can get ice on the water. You can be looking at some land. There's different kinds of RFI. There's many different things that interfere with the signal that you're really looking for. So one of the challenges is pulling out the information that you're looking for. So why microwaves? Why we might, as I said, there's instruments up there. There's geostationary instruments up there. You see them all the time, the GOES images that take nice pictures and show you the clouds moving across the ocean. So we're definitely doing a lot of these things in the microwave. Why, in the optical, why do we have to go to microwave? Well, there's a number of advantages to microwave. Fundamentally, it's day and night. It's not looking at reflections from the sun or optical images. It's looking at the actual emissions from the Earth, and the Earth is emitting microwaves all the time. So it's day and night. The most important thing is that you can see through the clouds. Optical instruments see the top of the clouds and then they're done. Microwave, you can see all the way through the clouds. I'll show you some images. You get down to the 10 gigahertz area, you can see all the way through the clouds. Even really thick raining clouds, you can go right through them and still see what's going on down at the surface of the Earth. And then depending on, by choosing multiple channels, you can go off and really look at different phenomenology. GMI has some channels that are very sensitive to rain, and then it has some channels that are very sensitive to snow. And so you can look at these different phenomenology and do different retrievals. So that's the advantage. So why doesn't everybody do everything in microwaves? So there are some problems. First of all, your wavelengths get long. That's why you can go through the clouds, is because your wavelengths get long, and so the raindrops are small relative to the wavelength that you're operating at. That's nice to get through the clouds, but to get any kind of resolution, you need an aperture that's multiple wavelengths. So when you start getting up into the tens of centimeters wavelength, your aperture starts getting big. And so whereas optical instruments have you can have a mirror on this size. Our mirror is 1.2 meters. You can get up to 2, 3, 4 meter antennas very quickly to get resolution that you need. The other problem with microwaves, when you're in the passive region, is that you have very little signal to work with. I'll show you a graph, but basically you're just looking at Planck's law, you have very little. And so you're down in the mud. You're looking at signals that are right at the noise level of the detectors that can be built. So that's a challenge. In order to detect those signals, you have huge gains in your system, which makes calibration difficult. And then there's RFI. And if anybody goes into remote sensing and goes into microwave remote sensing, they will learn to hate the words RFI. Basically, the sensitivity of this receivers that we have, if there was a single cell phone in my passband, I would pick that up instead of the emissions coming from the earth that I'm looking for. A single cell phone. So if there's one guy who had a cell phone and it happened to be in my band, that's more power that I would pick up from that than the total power that I'm trying to pick up from the earth. So you get these RFI, you get anybody that's transmitting anything, if they have a second or third side lobe harmonic that just happens to come into your band, it wipes you out. It wipes out your signal. You've built this beautiful instrument, and instead of picking up what you're looking for, you end up having a really good RFI detector that tells you how bad a job somebody else did designing their receiver. There's actual experiences with the AMSR instruments that flew on a couple of the Aqua missions, where they actually built the radiometer. They had this 6 gigahertz channel that they wanted to go look at soil moisture. They got no soil moisture out of it. All they got was a really good RFI detector that could tell them how much radio emissions were coming up in those different bands. So this is a challenge that we work with, especially on the passive microwave side. So just to try to justify that you can do this, Planck's law, it's Planck's law, it doesn't stop any place. And so here's a plot of Planck's law. It peaks out here down in the optical area, in the infrared area. But as you see, there's nothing with this law. It just keeps going out here. Unfortunately, it just keeps coming down. So the emissions peak out here, and then they keep coming down. So we're out here about three orders of magnitude off to the right. So that signal just keeps getting less and less and less. There is emissions that are coming off of thermal emissions that are coming off in the microwave area. They're just very low level signals. This is actually a picture. When you go to the airport and you go through those scanners, those are active microwave scanners. They used to have passive ones, but they weren't sensitive enough. This is actually a picture of a passive microwave sensor picking up the emissions coming off of the body that are getting blocked by these items that they've put on them as a demonstration. So, and it was amazing to me the first time that I built the microwave radiometer and I put my hand in front of it and actually saw the counts bounce up and down and knew that though that was actual microwave emissions that were coming off of my hand that this instrument was picking up. I mean, I designed this instrument so I knew that had to be the case, but the first time I actually saw it, it was pretty amazing. You just don't think of your hand giving off microwave emissions like a microwave oven or a big antenna, but it actually does, and that's what we're measuring, and we're just trying to measure it over very large areas of the Earth's surface. So this is the design of the satellite that was put together to do this mission. So right here on the front is the GMI instrument. This is actually a big phased array antenna that's on the bottom that the Japanese supplied. It's a KU and KA band radar. So it's got both a passive instrument and an active instrument on it. Another view of the same thing. This is actually the integrated spacecraft. The big radar's on the big radar here. There's another one right here. Our instrument in a stowed configuration. And a nice picture of us deployed. This is in our EMCMI lab where we're going to look at RFI to make sure we don't interfere with ourselves, that some of our electronics don't put out a signal right in the middle of one of our bands, which would be the worst thing because then all I would be picking up would be myself, which would be really embarrassing. So the instrument itself is shown here in this model. It's conically scanned, and so the instrument looks off the front of the spacecraft. So you can imagine this is the spacecraft, much bigger back here behind. The spacecraft is flying this way to push out a view on the Earth, and the instrument sits here and scans like this. So every time it sweeps across the front of the spacecraft, it cuts a swath at about 45 degree angle and cuts about a 1,700 kilometer wide swath arc across the surface of the Earth. Takes measurements. As it comes around the backside, it actually looks at these two calibration loads. This is where the spacecraft, actually it's actually this way, the spacecraft's back here. So the spacecraft is blocking our field of view here, and so while the spacecraft is blocking our field, we look at these two calibrations. Again, calibration is challenging because we have a huge amount of gain in the system, and then we come out of that, we take another swath, and we come back and calibrate again, and then we take another swath as we fly along. And so you just set out these arcs across the Earth, and it's set up so that those are contiguous arcs as we go across the, as we scan across the Earth.
What's the rotation rate?
32 RPM. Same for anybody who's owned an LP record player, which I doubt any of you have, but it's the exact same speed that the LP record player, 32.2 RPM. As I said, this is a 1.2 meter dish. We operate from 10 gigahertz to 183 gigahertz. This is the widest range of frequencies that a microwave radiometer has flown at. There's been some that go lower up to like 36, and there's some that go from 18 to 183, but we kind of went all the way across, and there's significantly different challenges at the low end and the high end. As I said, the 166 and 183, they're really the new channels and are there to pick up snow. And so everything's located on the spinning side. So all of the science, the antenna, the feed horns, and all the receivers are on the spinning side. We have the spin mechanism. We have to stow for launch. So we show, you could see in that one picture on the spacecraft, we stow for launch. The spacecraft actually gets installed in the spacecraft just like that picture. So we sit right up in the nose cone of the spacecraft. And so we have to be very compact to get up in that, kind of as it starts to narrow, get right up into that area. We're 130 watts and 166 kilograms. So 130 watts, just to give you a reference point, when you got up this morning, you turned on your hair dryer, that was about 1,000 or 2,000 watt hair dryer. So we're a tenth of the power of the hair dryers that we use in the morning. That's the total power that I was given to make this instrument work and make these measurements, these world-class measurements from space. Calibration, I'll say a couple more words about calibration, but for a microwave radiometer, calibration is the whole key. For this mission especially, because we were gonna tie all of these other instruments to the GMI instrument. So they're going to take a measurement, I'm going to take a measurement, and we're going to use my measurement as truth. So if my measurement's bouncing all over the place, and I tie all these other instruments to me, it just happens that I tie them when I'm high or low, and so the whole system is going to have all of these variations and offsets in it. And so it was very important from the beginning of the program that the GMI instrument be designed so that it could be the calibration standard for the entire mission. I'm not going to go into this in a lot of detail, but this just kind of talks to the technical challenges, the engineering challenges that we went through in developing this system. Most of these go to those calibration areas. We had to have a surface coating on the main reflector that was 99.9% reflective at all those different frequencies. The main reflector on each orbit, we go in and out of eclipse, and on each orbit, the main reflector goes through 140 Kelvin, 140 C of temperature variation. So it goes from about minus 60 to plus 60 or 70 degrees C every time we go around in orbit. I can't, I don't want to see that with my, I got a microwave radiometer that's basically measuring temperature. I don't want to see that variation. The only way I can not see that is if the reflector is really, really, really reflective at all those frequencies. So that was a huge problem that we had to go through to design a system, to design a coating that would work, that would be reflective at those frequencies, that would stay on the reflector over that really wide range. So that was one of the engineering challenges we had with this system. We had oscillators, we had noise diodes that we had to develop, a number of different things for the calibration. Like I said, I'm not going to go into these in detail, but this is really a lot of the technical challenges that we had to have to make the system work.
Did you have to calibrate the dish over at this?
No, we actually had we actually built our own antenna range inside of the clean room because I didn't want to go drag it out. I could have used my dad's range, but I would have had to take the entire system out into his dirty antenna range, and I don't like taking my nice clean instrument out of the clean room. So it was easier for me to build a clean range inside of the clean room. So these are just kind of standard measurements. The two most important ones here are any delta T and calibration. It's one of the interesting things about building an instrument. This instrument development was 10 years from the time that we were awarded it till it launched. It was almost exactly 10 years. So you spend 10 years doing the conceptual design, doing the critical design, actually buying the components, putting them together, testing it, integrating it with the spacecraft, supporting the launch, getting it on orbit, and then you produce a chart that basically measures 13 things, and then you say, okay, yep, it's all good. It all works. Comes down to these 13 parameters for the 13 channels, and you meet these parameters, and everybody's happy, and it works. And you just kind of, well, but this doesn't tell the whole story. But this, really, for a microwave radiometer, it comes down to any delta T, how much noise are on those channels, which gives you a noise floor. So how much is that channel bouncing around by itself when there's no input coming into it? And then calibration accuracy. When I take a measurement and I say that the scene temperature that I'm looking at is 270K or 320 Kelvin, is it really 300 Kelvin, or is it 302 Kelvin, or is it 305 Kelvin? What is the accuracy that I can determine and demonstrate the actual accuracy of the measurements that I'm taking? So for a microwave radiometer, in the end, it really comes down to these two parameters, any delta T and calibration accuracy. There have been a number of radiometers that have been built over the years. As I said, every revolution, you come and you look at these calibration sources, and they're your tie points. So you're going to get a measurement. It's going to be some number of counts that come off of an A to D. We have an A to D converter in here. We get some number of counts. We have to convert that back to some kind of a temperature that means the microwave temperature that you're looking at down at the Earth. And the way we do that is that we have a hot load that's sitting there at about room temperature. And it's a black body, so ideally a perfect black body that would emit down. And then we have this reflector that's looking off at the sky. We know that the background cosmic radiation is at about 2.7 Kelvin. So if you look off to the side, instead of looking down at the Earth, if you look off the side, you should be getting a signal at about 2 Kelvin. So these are our two calibration points. So we have one at 2.7 Kelvin. We have one at about room temperature. And so that gives me my two tie points, and then I draw a straight line between those two, and I say, well, I know how many counts come off it when I'm looking at 2.7 Kelvin. I know how many counts come off when I'm looking at 300 Kelvin. Draw a straight line. I can figure out for any number of counts what the brightness temperature is I'm looking at. So that's fundamentally how we calibrate the instrument. Conceptually, that's an easy thing to do, and actually building and implementing something like that is challenging. There are no perfect black bodies in the microwave area.
Or anything else.
Yeah, IR has the same challenges. So for any, there are no perfect black bodies. So somehow you have to come up with a good enough black body. Then your black body moves around in temperature, so you have to measure that temperature, measure it very accurately. Your black body actually has spatial variation and variation through the thickness. Microwaves are absorbed through the thickness of an absorber, and it's got different temperatures. So now you get all these. So we actually have 13 measurements of temperature on our black body. Well, what do I do with those 13 measurements? Do I average them? Do I do a linear interpolation? You know, weighted average, you know, all of these different things that you have to look at. Same thing with the cold sky reflector. You put a cold sky reflector on there, but if anybody's looked at the antenna pattern for in microwave, you get this kind of lobed pattern. Some of that energy that you want to go off and hit cold space at 2.7 Kelvin is actually going to go down and hit the Earth at 300 Kelvin. And so you get these corrupting signals that come in and cause problems. We also have the moon that comes through our cold sky reflector. Every once a month, the moon will walk through orbitally. It'll walk through our right where we're looking, and you see this spike. Every time I go through the orbit, you'll see this spike as the moon goes through my cold sky reflector. So there are a number of things that we have to work at to design the instrument. Here's some of the features here. I'm not going to go into a lot of details, but we really focused again on the calibration of the system. Spend 10 years of your life dedicated to an instrument. Then you go put it on this controlled explosion that they call a rocket, and hopefully it goes up and makes it to orbit. So ours happened to go off in the middle of the night, 3:37 a.m. in Japan. And so it was a nice spectacular launch, went up, it was a successful launch, it made up. Actually, the week before this, there was one of the ones going to the space station blew up. Just to remind you, just before you launch yours, that they don't always go up, and maybe the last 10 years you spent was going to...
Was that a Japanese launch?
That was not a Japanese launch. That was... But it just reminded you that sometimes they don't make it up where they're supposed to. As a lesson learned, if you're going to work on an instrument, I would work on a Japanese instrument. In the U.S., the safe zone is 10 miles. They won't let anybody within 10 miles. In Japan, it's 5 kilometers, which is about 2.5 miles. So we were actually sitting right over here on this hillside, right over here, looking at this thing, and the rocket actually turned and came right over the top of us, which they would never do in the United States. So if you want to really see a launch, work on a Japanese spacecraft and go see a launch out of Japan, because it is truly spectacular.
Yeah,
you just
go way back.
Go way back. So this, we were close enough that you could feel, I mean, it was hitting you in the chest, the force of that rocket as it took off. So, and then you get up there, and then they turn the instrument on, and it starts spinning. This was actually the first light image. So, as I told you, these are the swaths that are coming across, this arc that it's cutting across. This is the 1,700 kilometers from side to side, and these are the brightness temperature measurements that you're seeing overlaid on a map. And so you see we started in China, worked our way down, went over to Taiwan. You can see the difference in the temperature on the ocean and on the land, the different kind of land surfaces. So those are the types of things that we're looking for that then you try to derive the science from. We have 13 channels, 7 different frequencies. This is actually from the second swath, the second orbit that we had. We came up over the U.S., so we pulled that data down and plotted that data out. So this is starting from the left, the 10 gigahertz channels, 18 gigahertz, 23, 36, 89, 166, and 183. So there's a number of things you can see in these images. You could stare at these images for a long time. I'm sure the scientists would spend months analyzing and talking about these images. But there's a number of things that are very clear. At 10 gigahertz, your wavelength is on the centimeter scale, and you can see there's not a lot of obstruction here. We're looking down through clouds and things. On a scale of a centimeter, a raindrop is pretty small. So that wavelength is just going to go right around and right through a raindrop, right around a raindrop. It's not going to get interfered with by raindrops very much. And you can see that. There's just not a lot of signal that's getting interfered. You can see the you know, you can see Florida here. This is up over the Arctic, Greenland, Iceland, and there's just not a lot there. You can also see, if you go do the calculation for Snell's law, it will tell you that we're looking off at a 45-degree angle, and because of that 45-degree angle, there should be a significant difference between V and H in the two polarizations and the brightness temperature we're measuring, and sure enough, you see it here. You see that the horizontal channel is measuring a colder temperature than the vertical channel, which is what Snell's law says. So that's a good thing when your instrument follows the laws of physics. That's a good thing. As you start to move up at 18 gigahertz, now you can start to see some haze developing down here. This is down off the Yucatan, so that's where you would expect to see more moisture in the atmosphere going on. So you get up to 23, now you're up at 36 gigahertz. 36 gigahertz is about a millimeter in size and wavelength. So now you're down at the scale where rain drop is the same size as a wavelength. So this is where you really should, and this is actually where they put radars to go look at rain. Okay, you want the rain drop about the same size as the wavelength. So now you can really see there's something going on down here around the Yucatan. There's some clouds in here. You can see some different things going on. And then again, as you start moving up in frequency, you start resolving what was just kind of maybe a little bit of stuff. Now you start seeing some structure in here. You get up to these high frequencies, and one thing you see is that there's so much moisture there, I don't even get through the atmosphere. You know, in this area, you barely see Florida. You get up to 183 gigahertz, there's so much moisture there, it's just getting, the whole signal is coming at me from the moisture. I don't even see anything coming up from the land. The other thing you can see, if you look up here off the coast of Greenland, these low frequencies in 36 kind of said maybe something's going on there, but you get up to 166, 183, you see what looks like a frontal boundary. That's snow. That's a snow band that's going through there. 36 doesn't pick that up. Snow is much smaller, very fine grains of snow. 36 goes right through it, but 183 gigahertz at a tenth of a millimeter, it's going to get affected by that frequency. That's what you start to see. So this was something that was produced for the instrument. It was a joint project with the Japanese, and we happened very shortly after we launched, flew over a tropical cyclone that was all the way up, it had gone all the way up into the high latitudes. It was at 40 north, which is basically where we are, so you had a tropical cyclone as far north as we are in early February. Early March, so it's still winter time out there. So this is fairly high, a tropical cyclone, fairly high, and we flew over the top of it. And so this gave an opportunity to kind of show off the capabilities of the GMI instrument. What you see is our ability to look down into that tropical cyclone. If you looked at this is overlaid on a optical image here. And so this optical image, basically, you just see the outline of the actual cyclone itself. Whereas we're able to look in and see that in this area, there's a huge amount of rainfall that's occurring. In some of these other bands, there's not. Once you get outside this very small inner band, it's not raining at all. So that's a large cyclone, but because it's over relatively cool water, it's not it's not really intense and really active in the system. The other thing we're able to do is out here on these outer bands, you can see this snowfall here. So this is actual snowfall that's happening, and actually out here right at the edge of this tropical cyclone. It's getting cold enough out at the edge of the tropical cyclone where it's snowing instead of raining. So this just gave an opportunity to kind of show off the unique capabilities of the GMI instrument in measuring this tropical cyclone that had moved north into the kind of the cold waters of the system.
The new GPM microwave imager, or GMI, produced unprecedented images of an extratropical cyclone in the northwest Pacific Ocean, east of Japan, on March 10, 2014. The GMI measures the natural energy radiated by different precipitation in the form of brightness temperatures. The GMI produces a critical reference standard which unifies all the member satellites of the GPM constellation. The instrument has 13 channels, four more than onboard trim, and this greater sensitivity allows GPM to measure a greater variety of precipitation type and intensity. Each channel has a frequency range that can detect a different type of precipitation. The lower frequencies for moderate to heavy rain, the middle frequencies for a mix of rain and snow, and the higher frequencies for falling snow and ice. Scientific algorithms then translate the GMI's brightness temperature data into more meaningful products, such as rain rates. Because GPM's coverage extends beyond the tropics, measuring storms like these in the mid and high latitudes will improve and expand the global view of precipitation.
So nice slick NASA animation there. I could have emailed you guys the link and you could have run that and gotten 60% of my presentation. So, but I do think it has some good visuals. It doesn't show any of the engineering. We just have this instrument and it all works. So like I was saying, you know, as you work your way across these frequencies, you can really see, especially looking at something like this cyclone, where at the very low frequencies, you're looking right through it. Only the really, really intense rain interferes with that signal that's coming up. You get into the 36, 37 gigahertz, now you're looking at all those rain bands, really sensitive to those. And you get up to the high frequencies, now you're getting more of the structure of the ice and the snow that are in the clouds and picking up those things. So by having all these different frequencies across the frequency band really allows you to look at a number of different phenomenologies in the system. This just shows, as I was talking about, tying together this constellation, looking at all of these different instruments and cross-calibrating all of these different instruments. This just kind of shows that in an animation. So these are the two radars that are looking straight down and cutting this swath out. And now this is the GMI instrument with the wider 1,700 kilometer swath that we're flying across, cutting the swath out of performance data across the Earth as we fly. And then it'll start to show the different instruments. So these are all the different instruments, the NOAA satellites, the JPSS, the GCOM, which is Japanese satellites, Megatropiques, which is a French-Brazilian satellite, and we're crossing all of those orbits, so you get these co-located values that you can calibrate and then use all of these different instruments to fill in that global perspective and ultimately come up with that video that I showed at the beginning of the classroom that doesn't have gaps, it doesn't have jerks, it doesn't have really big swings in the all of a sudden this big storm disappears in the next image because a different satellite measured it. Instead, you've now cross-calibrated and tied all that information together so you can produce these different different systems. So, one more word on calibration. One of the things that we did with GMI was we put multiple calibration sources on there. So I told you that the history has been using a hot load and a cold sky. The problem with calibration sources are, how do you know when your calibration source isn't working right? It's your calibration source. That's the thing you're using as your reference. So if you get this measurement and you see something wandering around, you almost have to assume it's the instrument because that's your calibration source, but it might be the calibration source. So one of the things that we did on GMI is that we included some internal noise diodes that kind of serve as a third calibration. Now, the noise diodes have a known problem with drift over long periods of time. So over the course of months or years, they will very slowly drift in the output temperature, the excess temperature that they put out when you turn them on. But they're very stable over short periods of time. And so we put those on the instrument, and we use those in addition to the cold sky and the warm load. So now I've got three. So I can use the warm load and the noise diode. I can use the noise diode and the cold sky, and I can use the warm load and the cold sky. So I get three answers. And so if I go look at those, and two of those are really nice and stable, but one of them starts wandering around, now I have a way of starting to determine, is it my calibration source that's moving around, or is it my instruments that's moving around? This ended up being one of the significant things that we did. In the past, people had either done warm load and cold sky, or they'd done noise diodes. It was this, and there were two camps within NASA. There were the calibration load people, and they thought the noise diode people were idiots and had no idea what they were talking about, and you'd never fly a system like that. And then there were the noise diode people that just said, there's no, you know, these are good enough, and there's no reason to put these big. These are big and expensive, and they're difficult to accommodate. There's no reason to do all that. The noise diodes are good enough. And they'd had this about 20-year running battle with each other. And so when I first got on the program and I got involved with this, this was going back and forth, and they were trying to direct us without directing us to go down this road or this road. And I basically said, well, why don't we just do both? And then I can tell you, when the instrument's flying, I can tell you noise diode guys if your noise diodes really are stable. And we can determine whether or not that's a good option. And we can also look at this, use this to do these inner comparisons. It was something that hadn't been mostly, you know, with when you're going to space, flying anything extra is difficult because, you know, getting things to space is very expensive. And so that hadn't been considered before. But since this was the calibration standard for this whole system, they were willing to accommodate that in the system, fly both the standards, and it's been one of the primary things that we've been able to do to back out some of these low levels. And actually, we've been able to get from kind of the heritage calibration systems, which are on the scale of about 3/4 of a Kelvin, is the best anybody's been able to do. Our system, the final report that NASA put out came out that we're calibrated to 1/4 of a Kelvin. So we're about 3 times better than the heritage systems. Most of that gain was because we had these multiple sources that allowed us to go figure out where these calibration errors were coming from. The other thing that we have is this very large dish, 1.2 meters. Our cold sky reflector is the same size as the Heritage Instruments main reflector. And so what you can see here is our resolution here versus a Heritage resolution, where we're really able to go in and see the details within these different activities, these different things. Whereas here it just kind of says, yeah, there's something going on. Same thing here, where we get a much higher resolution. You can kind of see these details here, whereas here it's just kind of a washed out version. So those are some of the advancements that we made. So overall, the instrument's been highly successful. We're coming up on our 2-year anniversary at the end of February. We've been on orbit 2 years. It's a 3-year mission. So it's planned for 3 years, but the way that these missions always go, they plan them for 3 years. The spacecraft really won't run out of fuel until 7 or 9 years, and so we'll probably be up there for 7 or 9 years. But it's a 3-year mission, so we'll be 2/3 of the way through the mission. As long as nothing breaks, and so far we've had no issues. So we've been producing the science, producing those nice global maps like that. And putting that information out. If you guys are interested in more information, I included some links here that just have a lot more detail on the instruments, a lot more detail on the science working groups. There are people here at CU, up at CSU, there's a number of people up at CSU, Chris Kumro's group up at CSU, that are on the science team for the GPM that are producing the products and the algorithms that process it. There's a lot of information out there on the web in those areas if you're interested. And that's the end of my talk. If you have any questions.
Does that have any questions? And one thing that I'll say is Dave's talking about hot load. AMSR was a Japanese instrument.
Yep.
First one up on an American satellite. And the hot load was non-uniform across the face of the load. So it was colder around the side, not the middle. So they had to come up with a crazy algorithm to try to modulize that. So
yeah, they, again, weight is the primary driver for spacecraft, and so the easy, you know, this hot load is about this big, and we actually made it out of tungsten, which is an incredibly heavy metal. The Japanese, they didn't have that margin on the mass side, so they made theirs out of a composite. So you can imagine carbon fiber. Carbon doesn't conduct heat very well, and so they got these big gradients across there. We made ours out of tungsten because tungsten really conducts heat. So there's almost no way, no matter what you do to that hot load, that I can sustain a gradient across it. So I was willing to spend the extra mass for that load, whereas the Japanese, for whatever reason, had been constrained. They didn't have it, so they made it out of a composite, and then they had these huge 10 or 20 degree gradients across their load. And again, that's your standard. How, you know, now you've got to somehow use that to calibrate your whole instrument. It's moving around. It's got all these gradients on it. They chased that for years, trying to figure out how to use that and calibrate it. And no matter what you do, you're never going to get down to the level of a really good design. So, yes?
How real-time are you receiving the data, including the time it takes to convert the brightness temperatures to the meaningful range?
So since it's a weather instrument, that's an excellent question. So since it's a weather instrument, weather is really real time. So the requirement was that the end products, the precipitation, predicted precipitation products, be available in 90 minutes. So that includes the time to get it from the instrument to the spacecraft, from the spacecraft, get it downlinked on the ground, get it into the processing center, do all the processing, and have it available to the users to come pull it out of the what they call the precipitation processing mission, PPM data centers. They have that it has to be ready for the users in that PPM system 90 minutes after it's taken on orbit. And that's, for me, it doesn't matter. All I do is take it and just send it across the interface as soon as I take it. So it's no problem for me. But everybody else, that's a significant driver. Trying to get it down, you got to get it down to the ground. So they have ground sites that they fly over. They only downlink it on ground sites, so about once in orbit. So about every 45 minutes, you're getting 45 minutes of the date, that time disappear just before you even get the data on the ground. Then you got to get it to your terminals. You got to get the processing done on it, and you got to get it out there so other people can pull it in all within 90 minutes. And every month, they put out a little chart, and they meet it like 99.8% of the time. So they're doing pretty good on that.
Any other questions? Chancy's the one that's going to work with you, and she has to write a summary of this.
Okay.
And are you going?
Yes.
Okay. Are you writing up one for last night? Yeah, just email it to me, and I will post it up.
Okay.
Well.
All right. Well, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Dave. Appreciate it.